It's a pleasure to have Professor Peter Zoller with us today in ICTP Conversations. Professor Zoller is at the University of Innsbruck in Austria. He is well known for his pioneering work in many fields, including quantum optics and quantum information theory, having to do with the interaction between laser light and atoms, but also in quantum computing and quantum communications. He's on our scientific council, so he's closely familiar with ICTP and with many very strong scientific overlaps with faculty at ICTP. I'm accompanied here with by Professor Rosario Fazio, who is the head of our condensed matter section. Professor Zoller was a recipient of the 2006 Dirac Medal, awarded by ICTP for his pioneering work in this field, and also later on he won the prestigious Wolf Prize in 2013. So this is going to be just a free-flowing conversation. Let me begin by, so I don't work myself in quantum information theory, but I'm aware that in 1995 you wrote an influential paper with Ignazio Sirac, quantum computing with trapped ions, and but you started your life as a theoretical physicist working in quantum optics. So maybe you want to say a bit about your journey, maybe also with some personal journey into physics, but also your journey from quantum optics into quantum information theory and then into quantum technologies.
Yeah, I mean, I was educated more on the theoretical quantum optics side. You know, there was these early days when atomic physics as a field was still quite, you know, separated from what we have right now. And now we talk to condensed matter theorists, now we talk to, quantum information, all of that. At that point, atomic physics was a little bit an isolated thing, you know. Experimentalists were working on high precision measurements. But on the way to high precision measurements, tools had to be developed in the lab where people learned how to trap, for example, single atoms, like, you know, you take an ion, and ion traps were developed with the goal to isolate and then really hold single ions, and eventually also to cool them down to very low temperatures to make the precision measurements somehow better in this way. So all of these tools were developed of controlling at the end, how, as we see it right now, you know, single quantum systems, observing single quantum systems, which today in retrospect we see as the basis for building quantum computers. But they have really their roots in these early days and motivated by precision measurements, I would maybe say. And on the theory side during these days, you know, a lot of topics like open quantum systems came. How do we do laser cooling? How do we embed it in the theory also of continuous measurement, where we are doing then observation of single particles. We want to see quantum jumps, quantum trajectories, and all of these kind of things, things that are kind of everyday what we use right now in our work in the context of quantum computing. At that point, the foundations were developed. And this was, as I said, a little bit isolated from the rest of the community in physics. Atomic physics always had this flavor of being, well, these are the guy doing spectroscopy, producing high precision numbers, but you know, they have a laser, that's very nice, but that's basically it. And I have to say that for me personally, you know, you live a very happy life in this community, but the game changer was, I would say, in 93, was a professor at the University of Colorado in Boulder, and one of the Chila fellows. And there was a conference organized by Dave Wineland and also Carl Wieman, and both of them Nobel Prize winners afterwards for both Einstein condensation, and Dave Wineland got it later on for his work on precision measurements, you know, with trapped ions and controlling single ion systems and so on. And they organized a conference. It was called ICAP, International Conference on Atomic Physics. And they always had this conference had the feature that they invite one sort of, I would say, it, exotic, but in a positive, interesting sense, speaker from the outside. And I remember that Arthur Eckhart came from Oxford, you know, and Ignazio Sirac, who was my postdoc at that point, and we were sitting at his talk, and he started to tell us, you know, there's something out there, it's called the Shor algorithm, you know, there's a lot of motivation now to build a quantum computer. And he said that we address you as the community here, you're doing atomic physics, we know that you have laser light to control atoms, you know how to cool, you maybe also know how to do measurement. All of these things that in retrospect, the sites see, you know, were developed in the precision context. But would you know how to build a quantum computer? And Ignacio Sirac and I looked at each other and said, well, he talked about gates, quantum gates and all of that. And we said, I think that, you know, this sounds exactly what we might be able to do. And then within, on the scale of a few months, you know, we had a proposal ready to be written up as a paper, and our physical review letter got published. And this was sort of the historical starting point of the little quantum computers that we have today. That's now more than 25 years ago in 95, that at the end the paper got actually published. And today we have quantum computers. I mean, there's companies out there producing these kind of quantum computers. Are they useful at the stage that we have right now? Well, I would say that they have demonstrated a lot of the basic elements of what quantum computing is about. But you know, of course, we expect these quantum computers to be really useful, to be very large scale, much larger than we have right now. So there's an interesting journey of sort of curiosity-driven research that at the right moment, well, we have an answer, but what was the question? And then the question is asked and you see it as being relevant, you know? Mm-hmm. And that's sort of a little bit the historical context of how this came about.
After your papers with Ignacio, did the experimental group jumped in or how?
Oh, yeah. Actually, I would say it was amazing. Yeah. It was immediate. So I remember that Dave Weinland, invited me down to NIST in Boulder. Was also, and he invited me and said, you know, that's exactly what we've been waiting for, because you know, one of the reasons why we started to work on the particular form of the quantum computer is that I had to review, as an internal review, some of the Dave Weinland papers that were written on the linear ion traps. So they wanted to do high precision measurements, like also building better atomic clocks, you know, with single trapped ions. And to improve the signal to noise ratio, they constructed traps where not only a single ion was there, but a whole string of ions, a linear trap. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so I knew that, you know, mm-hmm. from reading these papers, otherwise they might not have passed my, you know.
I was confronted
with these things, and all they asked me to read these papers for this internal refereeing process, and so I got familiar with that. In a very similar way, you know, I got familiar with laser cooling because I had to be on the thesis defense committee for example, Stig Stenholm at that point, you know, and students. And so I was forced the whole summer to sit down and learn the theory of laser cooling. At the end, all of these things sort of fell together to become then a bigger part. And this linear trap ion computer where you take, you know, ions, I mean, charged particles, they repel each other by putting in into an anisotropic harmonic oscillator. They form a string like a Wigner crystal. And they have, of course, motion modes. And the idea was then to do entangling operations, quantum gates via these motions, and of course they could be cooled down to low temperature. We had the picture of quantum jumps, you know, that we had worked on earlier, maybe 6-7 years earlier, how to read out single particles, and of course they could immediately be reinterpreted as measuring the qubits. So all of these bits and pieces came together, and I think that sort of in retrospect, if I look at it now historically, this trapped ion quantum computing proposal did not only have entangling gates that normally people say, now, well, you showed how to entangle atoms. No, it was really the whole picture from, you know, how to prepare the quantum states, how to measure them, how to build the gates, and sort of it was a complete package. And I think in retrospect, that's kind of the remarkable thing.
The Vincenzo criteria were already out, or they come well, sort of the same?
For us, I mean, this is exactly what we had our list, and now they are called the Vincenzo criteria. We had them, okay, but it wasn't called like that, but so David DiVincenzo spelled out what sort of everybody in the community knew, but you know, he spelled it out in a very clear way that in the end was sort of the agreement that this is what we do, but we satisfied the DiVincenzo criteria sort of before they were explicitly formulated in this way, but this was exactly, so it was a complete package, yeah. And yeah, when the question is, you know, did the experimentalists jump on these things right away? And the answer is remarkably yes. Dave Weinland and also Chris Monroe at that point, there was a postdoc with Dave Weinland. They did then a quantum gate between the motion of an ion and the internal qubit. A few months later, this was the building block, but then they really scale it up and then have several ions and then do an entangling gate between two ions and so on. This was a journey that took then another 5 or even more years after that. But then there was really a whole series. You know, once you have two ions, you can do Bell states engineering. Once you have three ions, you can play teleportation. And there was then a whole series of rather seminal experiments happening that was just, you know, you add one ion, then it opens another playground mm-hmm. to play with entangled states and teleportation, whatever then there was. And then running first quantum algorithms in this absolute minimum baby form. But but demonstrating what the idea was. And this sort of has continued, and now we have in the trapped ion labs, you know, quantum computers that are in Innsbruck, the machine that we've been working on recently with maybe 26 ions or so, mm-hmm. but they can scale it up to 50. And Chris Monroe that continue was the in Boulder, the first one to do this first gate. He also has a company now, and with Rainer Blatt, we have a company also producing these things on a more sort of, I mean, I have to say that I'm not really involved directly in the company and the you know, things that are behind that. But sort of this was the product right now is really that you take what normally fills the whole experimental room, and now you can condense it into a rack and just, you know, mm-hmm. and you can then give it to your grandmother as a present for Christmas.
Yeah, and I think it's a fascinating example of what are regarded as very far-off, curiosity-driven topics about high-precision measurement, and what has now become a really booming, and there is almost a huge investment.
Yeah, but I would say that, you know, we live now in very interesting times, because, I mean, we talked about the history of somehow how these ideas came, and really I would like to give credit to my experimental friends for developing all of that. But what's really exciting at the moment, sort of, you know, if I look now 25 years back, is that all of these things were developed initially with the idea that, well, we had some big picture in mind. We wanted to build a programmable quantum device, you know, that acts as a quantum computer, and then to study that and so on. But we wanted to have it as something to play with as us as physicists, you know. Mm-hmm. And this, you know, this promise or this hope is actually becoming true right now, you know. Mm-hmm. In Innsbruck, we have the situation that there's these machines, and of course, you know, together with our experimental friends, we are allowed very often to use them now, in the sense that we have some theoretical idea that we want to try out. In the early days, you might have written a paper on this thing, you know, some theory paper, some quantum algorithm, but now very often we can just go there and say, can you try that out, you know? I mean, reality is not always so friendly that when you try it out, it works, you know, even though it works on a piece of paper. But sort of this whole story closes itself, that these ideas that were driving the whole thing, that were the motivation originally, they're sort of now becoming true, that they are now coming back to us as a toy. It's the mm-hmm. toy that we mm-hmm. wanted to play with, and which was the motivation for actually inventing this thing in the first place.
So another playground that you opened was with optical lattices, right? So.
Yes, this was
which has a very interesting connection to many body physics. Mm-hmm. I mean, is feeding also condensed matter from, you know, because there are a lot of experiments or ideas or situations that people could not study in traditional condensed matter, solid state.
And I have to say that, again, I mean, this was a paper written together with Ignacio Dirac as one of the co-authors, and this was, we had a very long and very fruitful collaboration during all of these years. Where the idea was only this, that, well, if I go back to the roots in atomic physics, you know, when people were doing laser cooling, there were some early experiments by, for example, Bill Phillips, you know, who had standing light waves, you know, you have two lasers that come from sides, they write them in free space and intensity pattern, okay? And at that early stage, you know, people did, for example, laser cooling inside of an optical lattice. And so this became a tool, it was very well developed, and it was sort of clear to me that when Bose-Einstein condensation was developed, you know, you don't have to make these schemes very cold, but you can use this intensity pattern that you write in free space as a potential. If you go very far with your laser from an optical transition, then it becomes a conservative potential, and it mimics like what we have in solid state physics.
I
that
see.
If an electron, you know, they're jumping around between cores, making metals or whatever these things are, mm-hmm. and now we have cold atoms, you know, be it boson, then later on fermions, that would then mimic these Hubbard models that we know so well, and they would appear naturally. The main difference, of course, being that instead of an electron, you have now atoms, you know. Atoms are much more heavy, so this means that the temperatures that you need in order to achieve that, you know, that you really can talk about interesting solid state physics quantum simulation, if you want to call it like that, would appear at much lower temperature, but the Bose-Einstein condensate actually provided that. On the other hand, by the spatial scale being much larger than the one that we have for, the normal solid state materials, it provided the opportunity by optical means to study single atoms, you know, while they are jumping and while they are moving around, taking pictures, the quantum gas microscope and all of that. So it was again kind of a toolbox where we knew how to build the basic Hamiltonians, and there was a lot of flexibility doing so. And it's great then to see the experimental developments along these lines, where of course the seminal experiment that started everything, motivated I guess by our work, was then the one by Emmanuel Bloch that did the mod insulator superfluid transition, where some of these things were seen. But then later on, of course, it continued, you know, in many, many directions with fermions and all of that.
So all the whole non-equilibrium, I think, it's a Hamiltonian evolution would be impossible in the solid.
Right.
I mean,
it's really true that the exciting thing is that these are really isolated systems. Yeah. You know, we know how to prepare them, but then once they are isolated, we can let them run and really do their many body physics, as quench dynamics, whatever it is, and then at the end we can read out and learn about that. And of course, I have to say that, you know, in particular in the optical lattice and so on, there I see a lot of future developments going on that. In the original form, this optical lattice was really well. You built a lattice with your laser lights, you know, and you have atoms hop around. This mimics the Hubbard model. But I think what we see right now is this increase in control in these experiments, that you can really have almost like a new kind of quantum processor with fermions, for example, you know, where you manipulate this optical lattice on the single side level, and then you get more and more programmability along these lines. So there may be new versions of a quantum computer sort of on the horizon that are based on these kind of ideas that may be useful in different contexts, like if you want to do chemistry and so on, maybe this is interesting. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So now the idea that is really that the trapped ion is like a qubit.
That's right. Right.
And so I just read recently that the number of qubits, like IBM had this announcement, like 400 qubits. So when you talk about, I mean, just to get an idea about what is the scale at which
optical lattice. I think it's very good that you bring this up. Usually, the beauty factor that people are saying is how many qubits do you have?
Okay. Yes.
Mm-hmm. But I think that is actually very misleading. You know, it is misleading to the extent that it is very easy, like say with photons. You know, a photon can be a qubit because it can have two polarization states and it might encode it there. You know, and so producing a lot of qubits is easy, some extent. You know. But producing a lot of qubits that you can actually control, you know, that scales proportional to the number of qubits that you have, this is a real challenge. So we should, whenever we talk about the quantum computing having so many qubits, also talk at the same time about how many gates we can perform with that, you know, because if I have a long string of qubits and maybe in higher spatial dimensions and superconducting qubits provide that, you know, the ions at the moment are still one-dimensional. But the Rydberg atoms that we have in atomic physics, we can talk about it afterwards, you know, they're also two-dimensional arrays. This allows you then to perform operations on these things. And the question is, how many quantum operations can I do? This has to do with something which is called the quantum volume. And so we should always talk together about how many qubits we have, but how many can you also control coherently, and how many of these gate operations can you apply? Because it's a combination of these two things that gives you then the actual, you know, power, which is behind.
So how long the coherence can last? Is that the
Yes, and also
idea?
The amount of control. I mean, if you want to do quantum computing, at the end of the day, it becomes a question of, you know, doing gates between atoms. What's the fidelity of these gates? You know, when you want to do gates and you're shining laser on them, there will be some crosstalk. I mean, what's the crosstalk? Can be avoided? Can be quantified? How do we control error? At the end, of course, then the incredible challenge of introducing error correction in this, all of these things, which provides a lot of overhead, and this is then sort of where we are at the moment in the developing.
So how big are these optical lattices? Like how many by how many? Four or five? I mean,
well, in an optical lattice, I would say that you can make a very large number there because it's not a universal quantum computer. If you have a quantum simulator, that should simulate the Hubbard model. You know, people are doing bosons and condensates that have maybe a million particles, you know, say 10 to the 6. When you load them in an optical lattice, of course, you lose a certain percentage. But I would say that in principle, a lattice simulator in three dimensions, you know, could have something like 10 to the 5 particles in principle. In practice, the experiments that people are doing at the moment, you know, because this would need also big lasers and all of that, of course, smaller number. But these quantum simulators are more like, you know, you have very many particles, you have a very well-defined Hamiltonian that you can control in the lab, but it's not a universal quantum computer because this, you know, in detail or universal programmability of performing then gates between these constituents, this may be missing at this level. But I think that what you're pointing out is, you know, an interesting development that we have seen in the last years, where on one hand we have sort of the universal quantum computer where we have complete control in terms of gates and you can produce any wave function by just programming it, but we can do it only for a small number of particles. And on the other hand, we have these quantum simulator ideas with a very large number of particles, but sort of very few Hamiltonians that we can realize there. What we see right now is that these things are sort of growing together, that these quantum mm-hmm. simulators that have a lot of particles, that we can program them individually, not maybe on the level of a universal control, but on the level of some partial control. But so we see a confluence at the moment mm-hmm. happening between the quantum simulator, large number of particles, the universal, you know, programmable quantum computer over here with a very small number. And then there's a lot of things in between, and this sort of space in between is being filled at the moment mm-hmm. and provides a very interesting playground. And as a matter of fact, this is what we've been working on actually during the recent years.
There is one aspect which I think it's I find fascinating of quantum simulators is that they are not only ways to simulate models, but you can invent reality. So actually, I mean, you can find
Hamiltonians which never existed
that do not exist, but right. they are allowed by rules of quantum mechanics, and then you can invent phases yeah. that.
So in essence, what you're saying is yeah. that there's the opportunity here to make sort of new quantum materials, like topological, exactly. whatever they are, with very interesting properties. These are not materials that we generate here that you can use for building better airplanes.
Yeah.
But they have all of the quantum properties, and when we start to ask very deep questions about, you know, quantum mechanics and about many particle physics, about correlations and so on, this provides the opportunity to study these things in this context. And that's exactly, I think, what the exciting factor is. So it's an application. So for people interested in basic science, I mean, this is of course fascinating. You know, of course, as I said, we're not building materials there, but you might consider this to be a simulation of an interesting material yeah. that hopefully at the end you might build as a real material and we learn about that.
You know? Yeah, but I think that's a very interesting point. I mean, as you know, there is very interesting connections nowadays between quantum information and also gravity and holography. Yeah, sorry, and but that requires a very specific kind of quantum system, which may not be so easily realizable otherwise. But if you have such control over the bits that you're operating and you can create, maybe you can construct a large N quantum Hamiltonian with a reasonable gravitational dual, and then you can study it in a lab, for example. So going back to, this question about, you said that basically quantum simulators are, you're manufacturing a specific Hamiltonian to study a specific
system. If you do what's called an analog quantum simulator.
Analog quantum simulator.
Right, where you find a natural implementation in a, for example, atomic system.
So I had read also that, for example, now about going away from condensed matter physics, you can also simulate, for example, you talked about Rydberg atoms, but also Schwinger model. I mean, are you now at a point where some of the really hard problems, like let's say lattice QCD, could begin to at least even think about attacking them using a very different set of tools?
I think that this is the ultimate vision. We are very far away from that. So of course, I mean, you know, if I look at high energy physics and when people have the standard model and they're doing the for equilibrium states, the quantum simulation, I mean, this is extremely advanced, you know, I mean, in the sense of doing lattice gauge theories and so on. And but there's a lot of problems that on this level are very difficult, for example, real-time dynamics. Mm-hmm. And I think that one should definitely see the quantum simulators that we are building at the moment, you know, as a possibility to enter there, and maybe at the end, this will be, you know, at the end of a long evolution, and this is a very tough and difficult problem. On the other hand, I also see a very positive slope along these lines, that we're making progress to develop, for example, special purpose simulators that, for example, want to simulate lattice gauge theory, like real-time dynamics and so on, to answer maybe at the end, or hopefully, you know, some interesting questions about fundamental science, but they will be done. And this is what's happening by you mentioning the Schwinger model as one example, that we are still in the stage where we take some very simple toy models of quantum field theory, like, you know, the Schwinger model, which is a one-dimensional quantum electrodynamics, you know, in the continuum is solved for mass equal to zero even exactly. And then this can be used as a kind of a testing ground to test yeah. many of things. They are on the level of toy problems, to make yes. it very, very clear. But yeah. I would say that when you also mentioned before Rydberg platinum forms, you know, Rydberg is another way of doing quantum computing. And again, you know, with Misha Lukin and Ignacio Zirac, we came up with ideas like the Rydberg dipole blockade, which underlies the simulators that we have at the moment that are being built. But when I see now that, you know, online, you know, you can now have access to a Rydberg quantum simulator with tweezers that essentially is 256 qubits, you know, in a square array. And in principle, you can even program that, you know, to a large amount. This then provides the basis where you can ask, you know, can we build, you know, maybe for a toy model initially, you know, at the end, maybe then more realistic for a really interesting problem, you know, something like a simulator for lattice gauge theory. This will start out by, you know, having maybe a two-dimensional system at the beginning. That's what we have. And talking about very, you know, abelian and then non-abelian groups like SU2, but at the end, of course, you want to do SU3. Mm-hmm. And so there's the interesting frontier at the moment where we're having these quantum devices, and then you might ask, you know, I have a problem like a lattice gauge theory, maybe non-abelian, maybe it's a toy model for you because we only talk about SU2 and not SU3. But can we sort of co-design a hardware which is like a special purpose quantum computer that's sort of matched to simulating exactly these kind of problems? Mm-hmm. And this is, yeah, the frontier at the moment where a lot of progress is being made and where I see actually a lot of promise also for the future. And these are the developments that we'll see, this co-design of hardware, you know, with the problem that you want to solve. You know, at the moment, you really have to match these problems and find interesting problems on both sides, but they have to, you know, fit each other, of course, in what you want to do.
Yeah, I mean, that's a fascinating, that you can actually, one day, I mean, there are a few really hard problems, and if you can somehow devise hard problems, but if you can find a quantum specific realization on a quantum computer, then you
and
know,
I would even you say, you know, you mentioned before actually gravity, this interface with gravity and so on. I mean, when we take what's called the ADS CFT correspondence, you know, we can, for example, simulate conformal field theories, you know, up to some level. I mean, look at the entanglement in there, and you know, the connection with quantum gravity, of course, happens on the face that, well, but that entanglement that we see on the conformal field theory sort of, you know, has its counterpart then in the geometry that you have then, you know, in the ADS context and the anti-de Sitter, you know, models that we have. And so we see interesting interfaces here. You know, we might be able to test dictionaries of translating.
Yes, that's what I had in mind, exactly.
That's right. Yeah. So I think that this is it's a little bit futuristic.
It may not happen tomorrow, but impossible. I mean, like, I don't know, people can now design quantum spin chains or something like that, which would have looked futuristic 50 years ago. But
yeah,
can,
so
50 years is a short time on human scale. Maybe you want to ask about...
actually the question which goes back to your initial introduction. So what is the relation, so what the contribution of quantum information brought to foundation of quantum mechanics? I guess, you know, issues that we are discussing now, entanglement, things like that, that now are used probably a few decades ago, were related only to discussion about, you know.
Also the Nobel Prize this year was.
Nobel Prize,
Of course we had the Nobel Prize this year, and we are very proud in Austria that we have Anton Zeiling. I know the time that he did this experiment.
He was in Innsbruck?
So, I mean, he was the one that actually brought me back to Innsbruck in 95, so he came and...
that's a really fascinating connection between
these teleportation
foundations of quantum mechanics and technology, and
So I mean, as you said, you know, this year we have a Nobel Prize, you know, Aspey, Clauser, Zeiling, and so on, for entangled photons, which addresses these foundation questions in quantum mechanics about entanglement. But it's not only entanglement. Entanglement, of course, is a fundamental ingredient. But testing this entanglement on this new frontier of, you know, large distance entanglement, which at the end then underlies things like teleportation and quantum communication and all of that, and the amazing progress that has been made. And I think it is a fascinating story, because when these things started in the 1970s, you know, with Bell inequalities or Clauser, Hohn, Simony, Holt inequalities, and Clauser had this vision of testing that, and then, you know, with the further developments by Aspey, that really made it happen in the lab, and this whole sequence of Bell inequalities that in the end led to quantum cryptography. I think there's really a story where we say that there were some foundational questions, you know, that DDN found a counterpart in experiments testing quantum mechanics in a fundamental new way on the different frontier. Normally we talk about, you know, quantum mechanics, it's valid in cosmology, we have high energy physics, we have atomic physics, nuclear physics. But this is really testing entanglement on the long distance, so it's really a different facet of the whole story. And that this at the end then becomes then, you know, a quantum technology where we today talk about quantum cryptography and we talk about teleportation, and this teleportation is then a fundamental element also of how we see networking of quantum computers and all of that. So the Nobel Prize this year was really given as a foundation's Nobel Prize, but at the end, you know, something that is now the foundation also for a new technology. So it's exactly what physicists are always dreaming about.
Yeah, you talked about quantum Shor's algorithm and quantum, I mean, I think there is also some fear. I mean, let's say, so there is, I don't know, what is your thinking about it? There is also certain, you would say, a certain hype about quantum computing, the promise of quantum computing being, it's natural. I think there is a lot of excitement and perhaps it gets reported in the popular media in a certain way, but there is also perhaps a fear that, you know, suddenly tomorrow somebody is going to figure out how to factor primes and, you know, figure out the quantum cryptography. And it's also hindering some.
You talk about the hype in quantum computing that you have. It's actually interesting to see. I mean, all of these ideas or this quantum computing discussion is now more than 25 years old, and I remember that the first maybe 10 or even 15 years, we were in the phase that, you know, when we were talking about our scientific work as really basic research at that point at conferences and so on, there were always these comments, okay, nobody believes that a quantum computer will ever be built. So there was this. But then at one point came this, I don't know, should I call it a sociological phase transition, you know, or whatever. There, overnight, everybody thought, of course it can be built. And I have to say that the truth is actually somewhere in between. You know? But I have to say that I'm getting a little bit concerned about this hype that we have at the moment. And I'm concerned because things get overhyped. We make too many promises, you know, and we sort of make believe now the public that the quantum computer is the answers to all questions that you might have.
Yes.
And I think that this is, I mean, the quantum computer is the answer to many questions and so on, but we should be very careful in being scientifically correct and not raising a particular in the public certain expectations, which at the end we cannot really fulfill as a promise. And hype at the end is bad because at one people find out that, you know, that these expectations that they had, being that somebody said it explicitly or being that it was sort of implicit between the lines and you raise the expectation in the public, that that you solve certain things which in the end you cannot. I think that this is very dangerous because it backfires.
Yes.
So I see, you know, in reality going on an evolution which is from, you know, the progress that we have in this context is amazing, but by overselling, you know, and you don't need certain individuals to do that to the outside, you know, overselling what we have at the end will be very dangerous, and there will be a reset, and we all will be blamed as scientists for not having spoken out enough about what these realities are. I find that the realities by themselves are very exciting.
That's right.
We have nothing to hide over here, but when we, you know,
but it's
if we are misunderstood, you know, what we're doing, then I think it is very bad at the end for us. And
I agree with you because I think especially, I mean, the scientific enterprise has a certain credibility in the public mind. And if that is compromised, and if people cannot really trust what is coming from the scientific community anymore, then I think it can be really...
Let me just add one more sentence that the whole discussion is very often reduced to quantum computing and quantum simulation. I think when we talk about, you know, using entanglement, there's a lot of other possibilities out there besides quantum cryptography or so, like, for example, quantum sensing, you know. I would say that quantum sensing is, for me, a typical thing where in physics, we build, for example, quantum sensors, you know, that are machines, that are measurement devices that use entanglement. And now on the interface to quantum computers, we are able to make, you know, completely new quantum sensors built around entanglement that will be much more precise. Mm-hmm. And I find this very exciting as a physicist because at that point, sort of tools that we developed, you know, we learned how to make controlled entanglement. We learned how to build an atomic clock and so on. We get now devices back based on our insights in developing quantum computing that allow us to build now better quantum sensors. which at the end might influence science a lot, because, you know, give scientists a better sensor in their hands and they will discover a completely new science, you know. So this is the interesting feedback loop which is started, and maybe this is not the way as a company to make a lot of money, because, but you know, from a science point of view, I think that the major impact that we will see in the future in this quantum computing simulation will be really on the science side, and that the sort of technological, you know, relevance that you can sell really as a company, this will be, you know, take much longer.
Much longer, yeah. But already it's really an amazing progress. I mean, to, I mean, even the Nobel Prize this year, I mean, the kind of questions which looked very theoretical and are really now being tested in the laboratory in a very precise way. And so maybe we can ask one more question. I mean, at ICTP also we are trying to, I mean, Saro is involved in this. We have this Trieste Institute for Quantum Technologies. And we want to develop this international consortium for scientific computing. You're on our scientific council, so you know a bit about it. The idea is to, of course, ICTP is not an experimental, we are primarily a theory institute, but I think all these tools, whether it's quantum simulation, machine learning, or some hybrid of the two, is going to become more and more important for scientific purposes, you know, quite apart from the its technological hype. And so that's the idea, that ICTP would like to make these resources more universally available to all the scientists around the world, and that's something that we are working towards. So do you have some thoughts on this, about this quantum computing and the hybrid, I mean, where machine learning?
Yes, there's sort of a scientific side, and there's the other side, which is an educational side. So, I mean, I think that one of the things that we are trying to do, in particular at ICTP here, you know, that serves, of course, the community by connection to also bringing in scientists from countries that are maybe not so well developed in physics at the moment, to teach them, you know, this kind of new physics that's coming. And I think that this educational point of confronting a young generation with completely new questions, but also new tools.
Yes.
So this is sort of a part of this whole mission that one has. But you're completely right that, you know, we are, you know, having new tools that are now available to theorists, for example, that are a new playground. We learn, all of us had to learn how to program classical computers. In the future, you know, programming a quantum computer will be as common as anything else. And so to develop a critical mass and to develop these things also, you know, across boundaries, I find important what I mean by across boundaries is this, that with David Gross this year, we organized, for example, a quantum information solvay conference. And the interesting part in this conference was actually the fact that, you know, there were people from completely different theoretical communities, you know, from, I don't know, from people doing quantum algorithms to many body physics to just name it, you know, there was something on this ADS-CFT correspondence. I mean, just the whole list of things here. And experimentalists talking about their practical devices. But these completely different communities were sitting around the same table. They could talk to each other. And why? Because there was one uniform thing, which was entanglement. You know, they brought them together. And these different facets, and that we start to think in entanglement in a certain way, and this becomes kind of a unifying language across these boundaries that we have in these communities, you know, and which at the end is an also inspiration for new physics, you know. I think that this is sort of the fascinating new things that's happening at the moment, and I see exactly this aspect also realized in your Trieste quantum effort that you have here.
Yes, no, thank you. So thank it you. Was, do you have any other questions? I think it was a great pleasure to talk to Peter. Thank I you. Think we should pick your brain a bit more about our plans for ICTP, for the scientific computing. Okay. You know, maybe you have some ideas or how we should organize ourselves. But thank you very much. It was a very wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Chat. Thank you.